After we state your name, followed by the pound sign. Into the conference.
Well, this is another topic regarding effects of snow. Again, sort of like the previous one, there hasn't been well documented in the literature. It's certainly a forecast problem we dealt with for a long time, but I don't think it's really been tackled systematically. And this is the trying to determine inland extent of more significant layer effect snow with these banded features. And, Joe Villani, a forecaster at the Albany New York office, and I have been working on this for a while now as well. Well, again, a quick outline. I'll go over some of the goals of why we started this work, our methodology, and some of our initial results. Come up with a forecast application that's currently you can use on the AWIPS, which is the computer workstations that the NWS uses. What we've been looking at more recently with our work and maybe what we can accomplish in the future. Okay, so the obvious goal here is we wanted to single out the most influential atmospheric ingredients seem to promote greater inland extent of significant lake effect snow. Again, use this information to somehow formulate a predictive technique that we could use real time. So, methodology. What Joe and I have done combined, I have looked at many lake effect snow events in the time period outlined here over the central part of New York. Joe has looked at events in his area more in the eastern part of the state. Did it over a period of about four winters. And the basic idea was for any given event, we hit the number of points at any one of the given four synoptic times, again, that we try to pick several points for each of these time frames inside the band at this time and just outside of the band. Also, we incorporated some 0 and 12 Z soundings if it was the right time and the band was close enough. We used a lot of 12-kilometer NAM initial hour sounding data as well to help us with the different parameters. This just pictorially represents what I just said. For this particular radar snapshot, the light blue colored dots is maybe what we would have typically picked. You saw three or four points were picked right down the band center line or maybe just downwind. We would pick a few points typically north or south of the band if it was oriented in an east-west fashion like this one was. And if it was the right time, we try to incorporate some Buffalo and Albany sounding data. And this is a cross-section of the atmospheric parameters. A lot of it kind of based on forecast experience, some of it on prior write-ups, that we had a reasonable idea might have a fair influence on the inland extent of lake effect snow band. Obviously, we looked at a lot of wind flow, some wind flow parameters in the mixed layer. One of the common conventional thinking is that stronger flow environments would promote greater inland extent. We wanted to get parameters to show how moist the mixed layer environment is. We looked at things like the width and length of the snow bands. Instability classes, how high the capping inversion was, with some convergence, and we looked for some data to indicate, too, if multi-lake influences upstream were active. Okay, and here's how some of the correlations, some of the results are worked out for the several years of data that we looked at. You can see up near the top of this slide, the numbers in parentheses were correlations that Joe calculated for his events in the Albany forecast area, where the bracketed numbers were correlations for lake effect events that affected the Binghamton, New York forecast area. And I tried to show some of the better correlations from top to bottom. It seems the winner here was existence of a multi-lake connection upstream. And again, this is not, this finding I think is fairly intuitive. If you've got a number of upstream lakes contributing to the moisture depth that the band has access to over time, it would seem reasonable that that could potentially promote greater inland extent. Correlations were fairly high. With just using a simple yes and no convention, was there a upstream lake involved or not? Correlations were fairly high for both forecast areas. Interestingly, fairly strong negative correlations came out for the differential between the 850 millibar temperature and the water temperature. So in other words, these strongly negative correlations seem to imply that as opposed to events that had extreme instability, it's like the events that were more either in the conditional or the moderate range based on Nizial's classes that he originally documented back in the late 80s. It might be conditional to moderate was better for promoting inland extent than the more extremely unstable cases, at least based on the events that we had looked at. Capping inversion heights, a fairly significant positive correlation in all forecast area, at least for a deeper mixed layer seemed to promote better inland extent, again, presumably access to maybe greater moisture depths. We talked about before kind of the conventional forecaster thinking was that this had a lot to do with strong winds. Certainly, as you can see, the speed shear in the lowest kilometer, the correlations are fairly significant. Stronger flow in the lowest kilometer did show greater inland extent, but some of the other correlations were a little stronger than the wind. So I think this demonstrates that it's not quite that simple, that it only comes down to stronger wind is going to equal a deeper inland penetration. So the bottom line here is based on these results, it seems like situations where you have a lake-to-lake influence, elevated mixed layer, perhaps old water instability that's more in the conditional to moderate range versus extreme, and strong wind flow in the lowest kilometer seems to equal events where your bands penetrate farther inland. And I have a type A here annotated on the bottom. I'm going to show you what I mean by that here in just a second. So we kind of tried to separate events that seem to favor greater inland extent versus ones that would more obviously favor much more shallow or smaller inland extent, inland from the shoreline. The favorable cases, the real long extent bands we call type A, the events where the bands did not extend very far inland from the shore we call type B. And this is just an example sounding and the corresponding radar image from one of our type A events. You see the elevated capping inversion in these cases up around 3 kilometers AGL. You can see that most of the speed shear was concentrated in the lowest kilometer versus higher up. And I kind of glossed over in the previous slide the relatively poor correlation between 0 to 3 kilometer speed shear and inland extent. So much better correlation in the lowest kilometer, and this event certainly seemed to bear that out. and the corresponding radar image during a west-southwest flow case off of Lake Ontario, where the band looked like went well into Passyat or Adirondacks and almost to Vermont at this particular time. And here's an example of type B, a lake effect band which stayed pretty close to the shoreline. Significant snow did not extend very far inland. In this particular case, you can see the height of the capping inversion more shallow on 2 kilometers. You can see the speed shear in the lowest kilometer much weaker in this case. And the corresponding radar image showing kind of a diffuse-looking band that maybe only went 40 to 45 miles as the crow flies inland from the shoreline. Okay, and this is another more recent type B example, kind of not very much of an inland extent. This was from this past January. And here's an initial snapshot of our inland extent forecast application that we came up with. And you can see application did very well in this event. Using a distance measuring tool for the radar on the left, I think it measured there 34 nautical miles from the shoreline inland to where the more significant returns, where the band seems to run out based on radar and satellite. And the number may be tough to see there, but I believe the inland extent application at that time was estimating about 31 or 32 miles. So it really did a very good job in this case, and Joe and I have noticed over time that the majority of the time there are certain cases where you would expect it maybe to have some problems. I'll go over that a little bit later. But most of the time, this the test bed cases we've looked at, it's done very well. Again, this looks a little bit more closely at the what the application looks like. Basically, the statistics and the equations we just talked about, we boiled it down to a multi-element regression equation. That's basically what feeds the final answer here, the inland extent estimate that it comes up with in nautical miles. And it should be pointed out that our application right now, it's kind of specifically calibrated for Lake Ontario. We really haven't delved into looking at other parts of the Great Lakes region or different lakes yet. That's certainly, I think, something where this work has a lot of potential, but we haven't done that yet. Okay, so again, kind of quick summary of some of our initial results. We looked at lake effect snow events, basically downwind from Lake Ontario, the northern eastern parts of New York. For the most part, for the cases that affected the Albany area, they were your single band cases, your kind of west to northwest flow, 250 to 280 degree mean wind vectors. Our inland extent application performed very, very well in these cases. It usually was within about 10 to 20 nautical miles at any given time of the inland extent based on radar and satellite. For your cases where you had real anomalously long bands that went well over 100 miles inland, it tended to underestimate some for those. In your northwest flow events, your 290 to 300, your 330 degree mean flow, you had a mixture of single bands and multi-bands. It still did reasonably well most of the time, but there were definitely times where it underestimated rather significantly for those cases, and we're going to go into that a little bit here. So it triggered us to kind of look at for the events where it underestimated what are the sources of the error, and it seemed that maybe just a simple toggle yes-no from multi-lake connection, since it was our strongest correlator, maybe that wasn't quite good enough. So how would we improve it from there? came up with this term of effective fetch, and basically it tries to represent kind of the additive effect of stream moisture contributions as opposed to a simple yes or no. So, and here's an example again of our inland extent application, and I have highlighted in a dark blue rectangle here, as opposed to a simple yes-no now, for our output for Lake Ontario, we have a number of choices for a kind of a drop-down, a pull-down. You could choose maybe just Georgian Bay was an upstream, was an upstream lake involved. Was it more than one? Like in this case, Lake Huron and Superior were involved, or maybe just Huron in other cases. So, just quick, you have your choice of model, looks at the NAM or the GFS. We have a number of kind of built-in locations that you could pick based on Lake Ontario events. And then the features on the right, they are automated that the application reads off of an AWIP slant bucket data. So I'm going to show an example here. I thought it was interesting that one of the previous speakers, he talked about a heavy lake effect snow event in December of 2010 in Ontario. We during those same days, we had fairly big events in our forecast area also, especially around the Syracuse area. This particular event, you can see I put the distance measuring tool on the radar mosaic, and significant snow from this Lake Ontario band went west, the Capital District in Albany, and even into the Berkshires and Western Mass. The inland extent is about 180 miles in this case, so anomalously long inland penetrations in this case. The extent application didn't do so well. It only estimated about 80 nautical miles at this time, where in reality it was more than 100 miles farther than that. Now, that output was based on the original terms of the equation. If you look at a visible satellite picture at the time, it's pretty easy to tell. They have nice input moisture-wise from both Georgian Bay, in this particular case, from Georgian Bay upstream, and, quite a fetch too over portions of Lake Ontario itself. So, what adding the kind of additive fetch term post-analysis sense into the inland extent application, we went ahead and added that. So if you were able to have added the choice of adding Georgian Bay in this case, the output was improved. It's still underestimated, but it certainly did better than the original. And that triggered us to do the same for some of the other events. And pretty consistently across the board, the results did improve where they were. The underestimate wasn't quite as much, or the itself was just much closer to the truth. Now, anticipating multi-lake connection is not necessarily the most intuitive thing in forecast mode. So what tools could you use to help a forecaster in that regard? Just a few I'll quickly address here, trajectory analyses, perhaps using some sort of analog or composite system. And then we talked a little bit earlier, the last presentation, about high-resolution models. Some of the related reflectivity products, perhaps, could be used. Trajectories is something that we started using more in our office here in a forecast mode for lake effect events, trying to see where the model forecasting wind flow and what kind of orientation and trajectory across a particular lake surface and where it goes from there. So that certainly could be one tool to help forecast mode making. And what Joe did in Albany for some of his events, too, is he looked at some synoptic composite plots, looking at different levels like 850 millibar pressures and wind flow and that kind of thing. And you could conceivably use that, and Joe did use it to sort of stratify a by flow regime or type of event, maybe for say a 300 degree fetch, for instance, that had deep inland penetration. Your surface features tended to look like this. Your 850 millibar features tended to look like that, or vice versa for cases where it didn't go very far inland. So that could potentially be a tool to use in this regard. So where we go from here, as far as the inland extent application, I think it's a really good start operationally. It seems to show some promise. Well, it's worked at least for some Eastern Great Lakes events off of Lake Ontario. But we're trying to work to add a graphical component. I think one of the limitations right now, it's a little bit black box-ish. It kind of reads some automated parameters, and then it cranks out a number. I think it would be interesting, like, if we could add, looking at a map, and maybe for different flow vectors, you could graphically see how far inland the application was forecasting the lake band to go with county outlines on the background or something. I think that could be really good for forecasters. And I touched on it briefly before. Certainly, I think this has potential to be adapted to other portions of the Great Lakes region. Would the exact same parameters and same correlations apply to other regions and other lakes versus Ontario? I'm honestly not sure. I don't have a reason to believe that the kind of the physics here would be horribly different area to area, but different maybe shapes of the coastline and other things like that, that maybe in a relative sense, the prioritization of some of these parameters could be different in different parts of the Great Lakes region. I think there's a potential here maybe to use a similar methodology for other places to explore building a tool for your specific area. Again, we haven't looked a great deal yet for how well the high-resolution models do with simulating inland extent in the future. I'd say anecdotally, again, I think in the cases where they've gone very far inland, I've looked at a few cases, gone back and look at the simulated reflectivity, and like the inland extent application, it tended to be underdone. But I can't say I've looked at enough yet to make fast assumptions. And that is all we have. So again, I'll entertain any questions.
Mike, this is Justin in Gaylord. I wonder if one of the things that you might be able to look at your way, you have a little bit more terrain than we do out in the out in Michigan here. If some of the reasoning behind some of those bands penetrating further into New York and some that don't, just be maybe just a result of just how much terrain they run into as they come inland. I mean, some of those Albany bands, you know, they kind of sneak down the Mohawk Valley and kind of curve down into Albany. You know, I wonder if just how much, you know, how much topography they encounter, you know, whether they hit the Tug Hill or not, has, you know, plays any role. I mean, an interesting parameter to look at.
Yeah, I agree, Justin. I think certainly in the cases that go into the Capital District, I think it's not that unusual for the band to follow kind of the lay of the land, to follow the Mohawk Valley. I've certainly seen cases where deep penetrating bands kind of did go over some terrain features, some different mountain ranges there where I necessarily think it would, but I think your point's well taken about assessing the terrain to see how much of a factor that plays.
Hi, this is Dov Bensimon from the Canadian Met Center in Montreal. Thank you for a very interesting talk. It's always nice to see some really handy tools that you can use on the desk. Out of curiosity, I'm amazed at the amount of work that has gone to this. Is it yourself that developed the whole interface, or do you have help from the informatics section to do this? I'm just wondering what the workflow is like. Thank you.
I had a lot of help. And as a matter of fact, Joe in Albany, he had more of a hand in the physical construction of the application than I did. And he had some people, I believe, from the Albany, from that department, helping him on that end as well. We did a lot of the initial work with coming up with the parameters to feed the application, but certainly had help with building that. And then ITO, the information technology people that we have here in Binghamton and Albany, have helped us in the meantime kind of maintain it, and they'll help us get some graphical capability.
Okay, well, nice teamwork again then.
Thank you.
Any questions for Michael? Thank you